So, thank you very much for your introduction, for inviting me. So I'm going to talk about the thermal reduction. Now, I don't have it on this screen, so I will have to turn around a bit. So first things first, this is joint work with Holmoth and Shirin, who are both in the audience. So I'm going to talk about model reduction and why we, do we even need model reduction. Well, typical network models, metabolic network models are where you look. So this is just the first hint I got out on Keck, and it consists of more than 50 different metabolites and more than 50 reactions. This is extremely complex to analyze, so it's often desirable to reduce those types of models. So then I also have in my title model reduction under parameter uncertainty, and so yeah, we really have three different types of uncertainty when doing dynamical models. We have the structural uncertainty. Are we using the correct model? And this is where the model reduction plays in. When reducing the model, we change the model structure. So we're trying to find, in some sense, the best structure that gives us the least uncertainty or doesn't increase the uncertainty when reducing. Then we have parameter uncertainty. That's standard model parameters. If we measure them, they're usually uncertain, and oftentimes we have very poor measurements and very wide ranges of parameter values. And then, of course, the initial conditions are also very neat and cannot be measured exactly. And then there's some numerical uncertainty as well present in models, but this part I'm going to ignore for today. So, model reduction, there are three basic strategies that are being employed. The first one is timescale separation, where people look at what happens at different timescales and focus in on one of the timescales, possibly set the things that happen too fast for the timescale considered to in steady state, and strategies similar to that. Then there's sensitivity analysis, where we look at which parameters a model is sensitive to, and then try to set the parameters to zero when it's not sensitive to changes in that parameter, or ignore the parameter uncertainty in parameters that don't have a big influence. And then there's lumping, which is a way of combining different complexes into one new complex and modeling these combination complexes instead of the original ones. That has the advantage that it, when it works well, it often is parameter independent, but usually it's not possible to reduce the model very much with this strategy. So the model reduction methods that we looked at was based on a paper by Rob and others, and it, the basic strategy was timescale separation, but there were some twists. So they assumed that the model converges to a steady state, and then specify a set of important model species, and examples are all the model species that we're measuring, or the model species that we actually want to look at while we're building our model. And we have all the other complexes we can reduce. So reducing means we set individual complex concentration to its steady state. So we simulate the full model first and then set individual complexes that aren't important to the steady state and look what happens to the model dynamics. And then we always calculate error integral, so that's the error between the full model and the reduced model. And so this error integral, that's just the integral of the relative difference between the reduced model and the full model. And so this was what Roland Anders did, and for our method of considering this together with parameter uncertainty, we actually required a symmetric error measure. So we symmetrize this by just switching the two things around and taking the sum. So I'm going to run through an example of how we did model reduction under parameter uncertainty with a very simple model consisting of only four states, four internal fluxes and two external fluxes. And we used mass action kinetics for this toy model. We can see that the red states are the states that we consider to be important. And the black states are the ones we can set to the steady state. So we're looking mainly at the concentration of X4, because this will change. And so in the original model in red, this concentration looks like that. The development, and then in the model with complex 2 removed, it is significantly higher. With 3 removed, it has a slightly different face. And then with both of them removed, actually, it looks fairly similar to the original. So that was our first point, that Rao and others actually looked at their model reduction method incrementally, removing one at a time and then stopping once the error got too large. But this actually might not be the right strategy, because removing several things can in some circumstances be better. Now, I have to say these were parameters chosen to show this phenomenon, and also this doesn't happen all the time, but it can happen. Then we did. We used our error measure that I told you about and did a single linkage clustering in with 100 simulations of each of the models. So the full model, 100 simulations, then all the three possible reductions each we simulated 100 times and calculated the symmetric error between all of these, and then we did single linkage clustering. And what we see here is the original model and the fully reduced model cluster together, whereas the other two are distinct and distinct separate clusters. So actually, in this case, the fully reduced models can't be distinguished from the full model, because of its parameter uncertainty. The parameter uncertainty actually makes that the structural uncertainty between the full model and the reduced model is less than the parameter uncertainty. So in this case, for these chosen sets of parameters and uncertainty, it might be enough to look at the fully reduced one. Now, here's the strategy in general. So we always generate 100 different parameter sets. We then simulate the full model and all of the possible reduced models for all of the parameter sets. We calculate this symmetric error matrix. We do single linkage clustering, and then we color the dendrogram to look at what seems to cluster together. And then recently we've also developed a statistical method of determining whether or not two distributions in the dendrogram are similar or not. We use the distribution of the dendrogram order and the Kolmogorov's Smirnov test for that. So let me now illustrate this in a more realistic model. This was the model that was used in the paper of Ra and others to show their strategy. And we used the same set of important states indicated in red, and exactly the same model and parameter values, but we added some parameter uncertainty, which they didn't have. And so this is these are the important states, those six states that were indicated in red, under the different reduction scenarios. And you can see that here there's two big clusters, here there's two big clusters, here you don't really see anything, and here it's a bit of a mess. So from just this you can't tell much. But then, as I said, we use the their parameter estimates, but the parameter uncertainty was actually not stated in their paper, and we also couldn't find it in any other previous publication. There were some ranges in some publications, but they were just incredibly large ranges from 0 to 100,000 in several of the parameters. So we chose to just simulate our own use our own parameter uncertainties, and we define the standard deviation as the parameter estimates divided by 10, 20, 50, and 100. And that way we actually got four different dendrograms that we then looked at individually and to see how parameter uncertainty affects the best model reduction. So here, what I show is the original models are in red. Those are also a bit longer, so we can see them. Then all the models that have F16P reduced are in purple, and all the others are in blue. So the reason why we singled out this F16P was because the original paper by Ra and others said that one can easily reduce everything else, but F16P should not be reduced. So what do we see here? Well, this is the case with the least parameter uncertainty, and this is the case with the most parameter uncertainty. So with a lot of parameter uncertainty, actually the original model is pretty much all over the place. So that tells us that likely we can actually reduce even further. Also, this F16P isn't that important if the uncertainty is so big. And when the uncertainty got a bit smaller, you can see that actually the this seems to be just about what they got. The original model seems to cluster in these others and not be present in the F16P. reduced, and the same for this. But here, it's, we actually see that even within this blue segment, there is some further clustering of the original model. So possibly, we actually can't reduce the model as much. So then we, this was just to look at it more broadly, compare it to around others. But then we also looked at them individually and looked at the best reduction methods as found with the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. And with the highest uncertainty, we found that the best reduction was the fully reduced model. And that makes sense. If we're very uncertain about the parameter, first the structural uncertainty doesn't matter that much. Then in the next case, medium uncertainty, we find exactly the same as around others. If we go a bit further, we actually find that there's one more component that may be important. And then for the very certain parameters with very small standard deviation, we find that we can only reduce one of the compounds. So in conclusion, it is important to consider structural uncertainty and parameter uncertainty together, because as you can see, depending on the parameter uncertainty, the structural uncertainty may or may not play as big of a role. It is sometimes actually reasonable to consider multiple reductions at the same time and not go iteratively, as we could see in the first simple example. We have a new strategy for evaluating model reductions with parameter uncertainty, and so far most of the published papers we found were looking at how should we reduce models and not how should we evaluate the model reductions. So these are more general points. When reducing the model, we of course should already think about how we want to apply it. So if we're going to apply our model to a different situation with higher temperatures, then the parameter uncertainty and the parameter values might be different. So we have to consider that at the model reduction stage. And the second point is, yes, we looked at model reduction and how to compare models under model, the scenario that we're reducing models. But in fact, this same strategy can be used when analyzing different models for this same thing. So we can look at 2 or 10 published models of these and see how they differ. Which ones cluster together and which don't. So that's an additional possible application of this strategy. Then there are some things that we don't know yet. So Ra and others use the steady state assumption, and we also make that assumption, because otherwise it becomes tricky, the error integral, if you move long into the future, becomes arbitrarily large if things don't convert to the steady state, and that's connected with the time horizon. How long should the simulations be so that we can actually make sensible, give sensible guidance? There's also possibilities to use different error measures. We use this symmetric error integral, but we haven't really studied whether that's in any sense the right criterion. And we also haven't tested this on larger scale applications. Our biggest model was these new battery states. So that's not really maybe the most common use case. So yeah, I would just like to thank everyone in the GitHub team, and thank you for your attention.
Are you looking into choosing different error measures so that you select which of your variables are you really interested in and which ones you can treat more like nuisance variables? So you don't care so much if you miss on some of the not so interesting variables.
So we're considering these important states, right?
Yes.
So the error measure, I maybe didn't say it, but it was definitely in the formula. The error measure only goes over these important
exactly. So this is where you can kind of tune the model reduction to different purposes.
Yes.
I see.
Yeah. Yeah, this is also important because otherwise it's not clear how you, well, yeah, how you would calculate the error measure if you reduce differencing. So this is really important that we have these important things, and these we look for the error, and these are what we look what we want to get right.
Any more?
So you said you wanted to test it on a larger network. How does it scale to the size of the network?
If we look at all possible reductions on large networks, that will not be possible. Because yeah, it scales quadratically. You can see, here it was really nice that we could show a different color for each of the reductions. But in this case, it got a bit messy. If we would show a different color for each of the possible reductions, we would have 64 different colors and you can't see anything. And this might be a problem, but it's always possible to only look at a set of reductions at a time. Sort of opposite to what I said before, where I said you shouldn't look at one reduction at a time. But maybe you could look at 10 reductions at a time and then choose which ones to further consider.
Any other? I have one. Oh, cool. So the reduced model, when you go back to experimental measurements, how does that affect how you interpret the measurements? Concentration of metabolites is fine, but I guess when you put together the parameters, it's...
Yeah, so the reduced model still has all the metabolites in it, they just, some of them are set to their steady state, right? So you can estimate all the rates as normal, but you have to obviously, you have to know that you're estimating those rates with this reduced model, and you can't then as easily go back to the full model. And there is probably some work to be done about how parameter uncertainty in the reduced model should be interpreted as parameter uncertainty in the full model. We go back, because obviously, if you use this model to estimate the new parameters, the parameter uncertainty will get smaller, and so maybe your model should not be reduced that much anymore. So there's,
So in terms of allosteric enzymes, is there some risk you pick enzymes with simpler kinetics that is easier to reduce? You talked about this phosphatidyl kinase step. That was
sorry,
the fructose 1,6 So the enzyme had, I guess, it's allosteric regulated in many ways.
I'm not really a biologist, so I'm relying on these networks in principle to be sensible and then trying to say something about how they behave mathematically. I can't say much about the biology.
Yeah.
That's not what I was saying, so I think we should thank the speaker again.